chit-chat during his lecture because he donates his time to come down here for us. Today his lecture is going to...
You do this for free?
You are. I forgot to tell you. So you would have put that car on the hold.
The check will bounce.
He's going to speak on prevention of a COPD exacerbation. And Rich is from Harvard UCLA Medical Center. He's an honorary PEP pioneer, and he's been a friend of PEP for well over 30 years. So, yeah, we weren't great back then.
I was going to say 25. Is it 30?
So welcome. COPD exacerbations. Of course, the question is, what the heck is an exacerbation? Well, yeah, if you learn that term, I can tell you what you can do with it. You go to your doctor next time and say, well, I have not had an exacerbation in the last 2 weeks. I'll say, well, exacerbations is really just another word for flare-ups. And this is a very important topic. It's, I'll show you, having a COPD flare-ups is one of the most miserable parts of having COPD. And nicely, it's one of the things that we've made the most progress on in the last 10 or 15 years, figuring out ways of having people get sick less often. Not zero anymore, but I think I'll convince you by the time I'm finished that we have ways of keeping people from getting sick, and that's really an important thing. The slides I'm going to show you are the same slides I showed to a medical audience. Talk down to you guys because I know I don't need to. The first thing is, are we really thinking about exacerbations very much? This is a scheme that is being used by lung doctors to figure out how bad COPD is. We used to do this strictly by saying, well, how much air can you put out? You go on the spirometry lab, you take a deep breath and you blow out, and they said, well, if you can't blow very much out very fast, that means sort of say, well, that's how we're going to grade how bad the disease is. But that changed a few years ago, and they added two more dimensions to it, saying that we can't just describe how bad COPD is by the airflow, by the spirometry. One thing is they said, well, how bad do you feel? And there's some simple questionnaires you can ask people to sort of say, how much does this interfere with your life? The other thing, which is up over here, is how often do you get sick? And if you get sick two or more times a year, it kicks you up into a higher class. And we actually are starting to treat people on this basis and sort of consider them differently, because it turns out for a given amount of not being able to blow out very fast, some people get sick often and some people don't. We're trying to figure out why that is and what we can do about it. Okay, so what is an exacerbation, a flare-up? Means you get worse. Transiently, in order to get worse for a while, a couple of some days or weeks of feeling really bad. You sort of feel bad, fluctuation. Some days are good, some days are bad. This is really beyond that. This is beyond the day-to-day variation. And we know what they're due to. It often is due to infections, sometimes viruses, sometimes bacteria. It can be because it's a bad air day in Los Angeles. We have some of them. Well, not as many as we used to. And other things that you're around, somebody's been smoking that cigarette smoke you're inhaling, that can cause an exacerbation as well. We sort of grade them as being mild, moderate, or severe. A mild one is you just feel bad for a few days. You may have to change your medications, maybe take more of that inhaler you use. Moderate means it drives you to a doctor's office and get that prescription. prescribed prescription for something or other, right, for an antibiotic, maybe an oral steroid. And severe means you're going to land in the hospital. And it turns out for me, and I'm a researcher, the modern severe ones are the ones we really track because they're easier. There's a defined thing. We're going to get into how we do research on this. If you ask somebody, did you have an exacerbation last week? And they say, well, what is that? I said, well, did you feel worse for a couple of days and change your medications? He said, well, no, on Tuesday I felt okay, but Wednesday was not so good, but Thursday was okay. So, all right. Did you have an exacerbation? I said, well, I still don't know what that means. So mild ones we tend not to track very well, but modern severe ones are defined events, and we can track those pretty well. And a lot of the studies we'll see are looking at those moderate to severe exacerbations, ones that need medicines, need doctors' input. Why do we care about them? Because exacerbations have bad consequences. The airways get inflamed, they swell up, the airflow gets worse. People who have a lot of exacerbations are more likely to die. People who have more exacerbations have their lung function get worse faster. Those who have exacerbations feel worse, their quality of life isn't as good. And the more exacerbations you have, the more you're likely to have in the future. And finally, from a societal point of view, if you end up in the hospital for an exacerbation, it's very expensive. In fact, being hospitalized for COPD exacerbations costs more than everything else about COPD care combined. So the us geniuses said, well, if we figure out ways of having people get sick a little less often, they'll go to the hospital less often. And it will cost less as well as save misery. Here's a slide that sort of makes that clear. This survey, 68% of the COPD dollar was spent on putting people in the hospital for admissions out of the $30 billion a year. Now, even though Obama money, that's a lot of money. $30 billion a year it costs us to take care of COPD. Why do people, predicts who's going to get lung flare-ups, lung exacerbations. This is a slide I borrowed from somebody. It shows a whole bunch of different things that predict exacerbations. But the biggest one is this one here, frequent past exacerbations. You got sick last year. You're maybe likely to get sick this year. How do we know that? Well, this article came out a couple of years ago. It came out in the New England Journal of Medicine. You ever hear of that journal? Everybody's heard of New England Journal of Medicine. It's the most prominent medical journal in the world. If it's published in New England Journal of Medicine, it must be right. I mean, it can't be wrong. And here's this study. It says susceptibility to exacerbations. Well, that means now in chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, and a whole bunch of distinguished people wrote this. What they did is they did a study. They took about 3,000 people who had COPD, different severities, different characteristics, and said, well, look, let's follow these people. We're not going to do anything to them. We're just going to follow them for about 3 years. We're going to make a whole bunch of measurements. And then over the 3 years, we're going to see who gets sick. And we're going to try to find things that will let us determine who's going to have exacerbations and who's not. And again, a very expensive study was done. And then this is the kind of people they studied. And what they found was, this is the outcome. They measured all kinds of lung function things. They took blood. They took genetic material. They took all kinds of stuff. And the only thing that they found that was really predictive was it was about five times as likely if you had an exacerbation last year, you're going to have an exacerbation this year. It seems like I knew that, right? You knew that. But this is New England Journal of Medicine, a thing that this multi-billion dollar study, this is their major outcome. So that's very clear. We also know that people whose lungs are worse will tend to get exacerbations more. And here's a slide that sort of shows that this is people with sort of moderate COPD, severe COPD, very severe COPD. And the blue bars are how likely you are to be, what fraction of people were hospitalized for an exacerbation in a given year. And you see as the disease gets worse, the likelihood of getting hospitalized increases. So about a third of people with very severe disease will get hospitalized. And also the number of people who are at more than two or more exacerbations gets higher. But you see here, this is moderate disease, which is really, a lot of times people don't even know they have the disease. turns out that if you look at the CT scan of the chest, you know, this radiology test they do to look at lung characteristics, there's a bunch of features of CT scans that can tell you at least mildly predictive of whether people are going to get exacerbations and get sick. So what I've hoped to convince you is COPD exacerbations are a major management goal. Our major goal is to try to find ways of decreasing the frequency of exacerbations, not to make them zero, but at least to make them less often. Now, how would you go about finding out whether a given therapy that you have decreases exacerbations? Sounds like a pretty simple thing, you know. You take it, you get sick less often. Well, it's not quite that easy. This is how you do it. Let's say you want to decide who you want to study, how long you want to study them, how many people you have to study. So let's say you guess that I have a therapy that I think is going to decrease exacerbations by 10 or 20%. That's worthwhile. If you wanted to see if it decreases exacerbations by 1%, that's silly. Who cares? You wouldn't take something that was only 1% effective. And you wouldn't want to miss something that it was 10 or 20% effective. So that's a good number. First of all, if you're doing this study, you want to find people who were having exacerbations already, because those are the ones who are likely to have them again. You don't want to study a whole bunch of people who aren't getting sick because they can't get sick any less. So that's the people you have to start with. And it turns out, if you do the calculations, you have to study about 1,100 people and study them for at least a year in order to find out whether the therapy works. Now, you think about a study to do that, 1,000 people for at least a year, see whether they given a given intervention, given drug, versus not. It has to be done blinded, so you don't want to know what you're getting. It has to be done placebo-controlled, in an inactive substance, so nobody knows what's going on. 1,100 people for a year. So you can see that this is a major job to find out whether various things give benefits. You see, some of the evidence I'll show you don't really come up to these standards. But here's my list. So this is my list of things that we've defined in the last 10 or 15 years that decrease the frequency of COPD flare-ups. The first one won't come as a surprise. If you stop smoking, things get better. But think about how you find that out. Okay, so you take 1,000 people, and you'd have, you tell 1,000 of them to start smoking and tell them 500 people to start smoking and tell 500 people not to smoke. Yeah. How would that be? No. You don't want to do that. Okay, you take 1,000 smokers and you tell 500 of them to stop and let 500 of them continue. You can't do that either, because first of all, not so sure those 500 will stop, and you wouldn't want to tell anybody to continue. So here's the evidence we have, not perfect, but this is a study called the Lung Health Study, a very large study funded by your tax dollars, published about 10, 12 years ago. They took 5,800, about 6,000 smokers, and gave them all smoking cessation reports. And as a result, some people didn't care, they kept on smoking. Some people smoked a little bit at a time, and some people actually stopped. So they looked at those who continued to smoke and those who managed to stop smoking, and they looked at how often they got sick. And you see here the group who continued to smoke, their exacerbation frequency only continued to rise, and those who stopped, it went down, and then continued to rise a little bit. But look, they got sick less often. That looks pretty good. Actually, I hadn't looked at this very closely, but that's a 35% decrease in getting sick just from stopping smoking. So, and that's about as good as we're going to get. 35% is a big decrease. So there's no question, even though this isn't a perfect study because we didn't randomize people exactly, still it's good evidence, and we don't doubt that stopping smoking is a good thing to do if you don't want to get sick as often. Okay? Second one here is, again, another no-brainer. Vaccination for flu and for pneumococcal disease is, again, something that we expect to have people get sick less often. Our data isn't awfully good because, again, it's hard to randomize people, tell people, you don't get a flu shot this year. we'll see what happens. We don't want to do that, right? But in fact, studies that are pretty good indicate quite clearly that people who take flu shots don't get sick as often. They don't get the flu, doesn't go on to something more serious. And similarly, the pneumococcal vaccines we have, Pneumovax, new ones out, they also prevent people from getting sick. So when your doctor says it's time for your flu shot, say, thank you, yes, I'll take that. And every 5 years, usually, a pneumococcal vaccine is something to take. And these are, again, things that will make you get sick less often. Now we get to some of the drugs that we take, you know, the doctor prescribes. One is the inhaled steroids. Now, a lot of you will have drugs like Advair or Symbicort. They contain inhaled steroids. And the question is, these are drugs that sort of are supposed to decrease the swelling in the lung, decrease inflammation in the lung. Do these decrease the amount of time people get sick? And to do that, again, you know, this is the late 1990s. There was a bunch of trials that were done trying to see if inhaled steroids really worked in COPD. We had some doubts. We know they worked very well in asthma. We weren't sure about the COPD. Four trials. And one of those four trials studied people who were severe enough so that they were having exacerbations. And when they looked at the data, they found that, in fact, this is the trial, the Soli trial, and these people, with 751 patients, studied for a year or two, they actually had a 25% reduction in exacerbations when they took inhaled steroids. So that's another checkbox. So inhaled steroids, if you're having exacerbations, you're going to get sick less often. Good news. The fourth one is sort of a little bit more mysterious. We sort of understand sort of why inhaled steroids might do it, because it lessens inflammation, and inflammation has something to do with having flare-ups. But here's our good friend, long-acting bronchodilators. What am I talking about? I'm talking about beta-agonist anticholinergics, Spiriva, Symbicort has them, different kinds. The bronchodilators that we take chronically, and these are good drugs because they make our airflow easier, but do they actually decrease the amount of times you get sick? And one of the mysteries it turns out here is, why might that work? Why would you think that something that makes airway muscle relax a little bit make you get sick less often? And you scratch your head, you come up with some vague ideas, but there's no clear reason why that might be true. One of the ideas is to keep the airways open a little bit more. It's easier to get stuff out. Easier to cough up bad stuff. That may be true, but really there was no great reason to see that's true. But in fact, studies have been shown this for quite a while. I like to show this slide because why? Because welcome to my, there's my name. Show a slide with my name on it. These are studies from the Tiotropium spiriva experience, which goes back 10 years or so, when we were just learning something about the drug, where we were trying to find out if it was a good bronchodilator. It's a fine bronchodilator. But we record everything that happens to people, and when they started looking at this data, they found that if you did a trial, 1 year trial versus people taking placebo versus taking spiriva, or taking the older drug, Atrovent or Combivent versus spiriva, or another trial, and did it for a year, did it with 1,000 people in each group, and things like that, pretty regularly, 20% fewer exacerbations, 24%, 28%, people were getting sick less often if they were in the group that got this good bronchodilator. That's interesting, isn't it? That was confirmed in a much larger trial a few years later, where they randomized 6,000 people to receive Spiriva or receive placebo for 4 years. Big trial, big money. That's why these drugs are expensive. And found that this is the probability of getting sick. You see the Spiriva group is lower all the way along by about 14%. 14% fewer illnesses from COPD in people who are taking Spiriva. And importantly, 14% reduction. And importantly, looking at hospitalizations for COPD exacerbations, again, lower than the Spiriva group. So you get to the hospital less often. So it only Spiriva? No, it turns out that other long-acting bronchodilators work well. This is salmeterol, which is in Advair. Now, Advair decreases, here's a group with four different combinations, but here's placebo, and here is salmeterol, the bronchodilator in Advair, and it turns out a 20% reduction in getting sick. So again, it looks like taking drugs that last most of the day make you get sick less often. So taking good bronchodilators seems to help. We have some other bronchodilators that are on the market now, aclidinium or Tudorza. Some of you may be taking instead of Spiriva, or indacaterol, which is instead of the drugs in Advair or Symbicort, which is a once-a-day drug, also is a good drug. But it turns out that these haven't been, the FDA hasn't been convinced, because the studies haven't been done, that these decrease exacerbations. But they probably do, because the way they act is probably pretty similar. You might ask, if you had to choose between two different kinds of bronchodilators, which one works better in terms of decreasing exacerbations? I would say, well, who cares? You take both of them. And I'll show you data about that in a while. But this is a trial, again, published in New England Journal of Medicine, must be right, where they randomized people to receive either salmeterol, the kind of drugs in Advair, or tiotropium, Spiriva, and follow them, one or the other, follow them for a year. And in fact, it looked like tiotropium worked a little bit better than salmeterol. So if you were forced to choose one or the other, tiotropium might be the, Spiriva might be the better drug. But again, I don't think it's very important, because you're probably going to take both of them. There's a new kid on the block, phosphodiesterase 4 inhibitors. What's that? That's a chemical that's supposed to be an anti-inflammatory drug, and it's called, chemical name is roflumilast, its trade name is, it's not Tudorza, it's Dalarest. Got it, Dalarest. Dalarest was approved by the FDA about 2 years ago. It's actually the first new drug for COPD, the first truly new drug for COPD, and it's, They did registration trials for the FDA, about 3,000 people with severe to very severe COPD who are having exacerbations, who had bronchitic symptoms, coughing and sputum production, and randomized those into trial and looked at for over a year's time. Imagine how difficult and expensive this is. And in fact found, this is the money shot, this is 17% fewer exacerbations. That means if you lined up four people office and they're all get these characteristics, they have severe disease and they were having coughing sputum reduction and they had exacerbations last year. If you had four people lined up like that and you gave it to all four of them over a year's period, one of them would get one fewer exacerbation. That may not sound like a lot, but actually that's pretty decent for a drug. And that's on top of whatever they were taking before. This is an added drug. And this drug is being seen used in people who are having pretty frequent exacerbations. Drug you put on top of it to see if you can make that a little bit better. This is a study that I was involved in. Well, we know that some exacerbations, some flare-ups are caused by bacteria, by bugs. And what if we gave people, suppress their bugs all the time, gave them antibiotics? Now, my infectious disease friends go bananas about this because we know if we give everybody antibiotics, we lose them. Because the bugs get resistant. But still, it's still a valid scientific question. I'll talk about that in a minute. But we tried this, and here's a New England Journal of Medicine, important study with, where is it? There's me. I'm a nurse. And we did this. This was done at Harvard UCLA. A couple of you in here may have participated. Thank you very much for that. We gave people azithromycin. Zithromax, Z-Pax, stuff. We gave them one pill a day, every day, for a year, plus anything else they were taking, versus placebo. Placebo or the drug, we don't know what you're getting. And did that for 1,142 people across the United States. We did, I think, 99 at Harvard. And we Christmas present at the end, and unblind the study to find out what the answer was. Here's essentially the plot. This is the probability of having, not having an exacerbation. So start off with one, and then you have people have exacerbations, and on till the end of the year. And here's the zithromycin, here's placebo, and it looks like it's more likely you're going to get sick if you were on the placebo group than on the zithromycin group. That's 27% reduction. That's actually pretty good. So if you take an antibiotic once a day, chronically, you're going to get sick less often in this kind of population of people who are getting sick, getting exacerbations. Again, this doesn't mean that everybody should go out and take azithromycin all the time. But what it does for doctors is it lets them, gives them leave to take a person who's having trouble with persistent exacerbations, having trouble with it. This is something that they can try to see if they can make things better, even though the infectious disease people don't like the idea. And we did some sub-analyses on these to show what kind of people seem to be benefit. And if you're on the left-hand side of the line, it means you're benefiting. And we couldn't find really predictors of anything that would say, well, these people would benefit, these people would. It looks like everybody would benefit. With the exception of this one here, people who continued to smoke, they didn't seem to benefit very much. Let me think. Well, what about pulmonary rehabilitation?
Yay!
Absolutely. I'll tell you a little story about this. About 20 years ago, Mary Burns, our esteemed former leader of this group, gave me some data and asked me to analyze it. She went and looked and had a bunch, maybe 200 people who had gone through the PEP program, and had information about how often they had gotten sick the year before the program, and how often they had gotten sick in the couple of years after the program. And it turned out that it wasn't subtle. People were getting sick a lot less. Now, it turns out that those data aren't exactly scientifically great, because people often get into a program because they got sick. So that's not, you didn't randomize them to do rehabilitation or prevention. The way to do a study like that is to get 1,000 people and say, do you want to do rehabilitation? They say, oh yeah, I want to do rehabilitation. And tell half of them, no, you can't. And let half of them do the rehabilitation program. And then see who gets sick more. We can't do that. We don't do that. So, but again, this group contributed data that I think was quite impressive in terms of rehabilitation being a benefit in terms of getting sick. This is a study that was published about 10 or 12 years ago where they sort of randomized 200 people to get rehabilitation or not and found out that their hospital, if they got admitted to the hospital, their length of stay was a good deal lower if they got rehabilitation. Studies aren't great. This is, again, another series of studies, not very many people in them because the drug companies have the money to do big studies, rehabilitation people don't. So this one suggests that if you are hospitalized for an exacerbation, for a flare-up, and you do a rehabilitation shortly thereafter, that your chances of getting readmitted fall. This is another piece of data. Not great science, but suggesting that rehabilitation works. I really believe rehabilitation decreases the amount of time people get sick. What's collaborative self-management? This means working very closely with your doctors and the nurses and the medical people, be able to access them quickly if you're feeling bad, getting care promptly. This seems to be a good thing to do. These data aren't particularly impressive on that regard. I won't explain them, but it's pretty obvious that if you have close contact with other medical people and get treated early for your illness, that you tend to not have it go on to get something more serious. Oxygen therapy, I believe in oxygen therapy. I see some people out there who believe in it as well. And in fact, there's some studies that have shown people comparing what happened before versus after they started on oxygen therapy in terms of hospitalizations for COPD in Denmark, of all places, seemed to show that long-term oxygen therapy makes people get sick less often if they actually qualify for it. So that's the list. The next question is, we got a couple others. Who's on a statin? Lipitor or whatever. Yeah, me too. I cells. And the question is, does that work in the lung? Is it anti-inflammatory in the lung? And there's some data that suggests it might be. But you can't tell medicine, you can't tell anything unless you go and study it. So the question is, do statins work? So we took this on. After we finished our antibiotic study, this group of sites, part of the COPD Clinical Research Network, were one of those sites, decided to do this study called STATCOPE. It's a statins and COPD exacerbations study. And we're going to study 1,132 COPD people with a history of exacerbation who didn't have any cholesterol indications. So if you have your cholesterol's high, are we going to tell you to stop taking your statin? No, we can't do that. So if you're already on statins, you can't participate. If we bring you in and we do a test and find that you should be on statins, can't be in the study. So it was harder to recruit people. So these are people who don't have statin, who don't have cholesterol indications, and randomize them to take a good statin, moderate dose, versus placebo for 1 to 3 years, and looked at how often they got sick. It says here we've studied 871 subjects to date. Well, it turns out it's not exactly true because the study stopped. Why did it stop? It stopped because they looked at the data at this point, 871 out of 1,100, and found there was no effect. Nothing was happening. The number of people getting sick was identical, the two groups, and wasn't any reason to go on. Now, that's not, you'd say, well, that means the study failed. Well, no, it didn't. It showed that it doesn't work. It shows that people who have COPD and don't have cholesterol indications or shouldn't be on statins, because there's no benefit. And we just submitted this study to the New England Journal of Medicine, who likes positive studies better than negative studies, to be honest, but they still may publish it. So this study just ended, and many of you participated in it. I really, really appreciate it. But we decided it was called futility. It was futile to keep on anymore, because even recruiting the next quarter, people wouldn't have shown anything different. So we stopped the study. Another question you might ask is, well, you've done one of these things, you get lowered exacerbations. Should you try two of them? How about four of them? Should you try all of them in the list? Well, you can sort of figure it out that doing that, those studies is difficult too. You have to have people on one versus two versus three. How many people you have to study? Well, you do a study with 100,000 people in it and have them different numbers in different groups and randomize them and do it for a year. Well, nobody's going to do that. So the question is, are they additive, or is one enough? This study I showed you before sort of helps you with that. This is a group receiving. This group here is receiving a combination drug, which is exactly Advair. This group received only the steroid component. This group received only the bronchodilator component, and this group received nothing. And you can see there's a fall. And taking both of them is better than taking either of them alone. Tends to indicate there's some additivity. There's another study, I won't tell you the details of this. This says if you're taking a beta agonist, bronchodilator, like Advair or Symbicort, and you add on something like tiotropium, Spiriva, do you have additive benefit? And this study seems to show that, in fact, you do. So two bronchodilators are better than one. And we assume, therefore, that the more of these things you are consuming, that the better things are going to be, as long as they're indicated for you. So, my conclusion is people who are treated well should have appreciably fewer exacerbations. And my real theory is that people who are around today versus people who were around 15 years ago, I used to come in lecture here, are actually going to get sick appreciably less often. And that's a good thing. I'll leave you with a picture of our new building. We moved into there about a year ago. Usually Harvard UCLA buildings are sort of raspy and nasty and stuff like that. We moved into a brand new building built for us. We're in there with a couple of other research groups here, but they're specifically built for the rehabilitation clinical trial center, our research group. And you can go over here and visit us. This is a nice new quarters. And here's the cast of characters. Some of you may know Dr. Forsas, who's a we're busy doing research. We invite you to come over and visit us. Let me see, what do we have going on now? We've got a study of a drug that decreases, that makes people who are losing weight have their weight increase, have their muscles, increases muscle mass. We have a study where we're trying out ways of improving lung function by putting valves into areas that are not functioning right now, bronchial valves. We've got studies of new bronchodilators, whole new crew of bronchodilators that are coming out, and pretty soon you'll be taking one puff of a bronchodilator of an inhaler a day. That's going to be enough. You only have to do this one. It'll have several drugs in it, and it's only going to be once a day. What else are we doing? A study where we're trying to see whether Motrin, like I said, we're trying statins to see if that helps lung function because it's anti-inflammatory. Motrin is a perfectly good anti-inflammatory drug. Does that help the lungs? Well, we don't know. We're trying to find out. We have an oxygen trial that's been going on for quite a while. People who don't quite meet criteria for oxygen, whether it benefits them. We're doing a very big genetic study, but you can't participate. If you have participated in our COPD gene study, either we've called you back or we're going to call you back soon, because we recruited 760 people out of the 10,000 people who were recruited around the United States. And those people are now coming back for their five-year revisit to find out how they did, see what genetic influences look like. That's an absolutely wonderful study. But I think I'll stop talking now, and I'd be glad for any questions about exacerbations or flare-ups or anything else you want to talk about.
This is not about exacerbations, but what you just mentioned, the valve study, what is that?
The question is, what is the valve study? Let me try to take a step back. About 15 years ago, this theory was put forward that some people with COPD have good parts and bad parts of their lungs. Usually it's the top of their lungs that sort of gets Swiss cheesy and emphysemic. And if you take away that Swiss cheesy stuff, the better parts of the lungs sort of can re-expand and function better. And there was a big trial done doing surgery to cut out the bad parts of the lung. And it turned out it worked. If you selected the people correctly, it worked pretty well. And people lived longer and had better lung function and stuff like that. But doing surgery on people, it's not such a good thing. So the idea is to try to find other ways of doing that. One way of doing that is to take, through a bronchoscope, put down there, you can insert a tiny little valve about this big into an airway that goes to a part of the lung that's not functioning very well. And that valve lets air out, but what doesn't let air in. So that area of the lung tends to collapse down. And again, do that instead of having it removed by surgery, remove it by having it collapsed. And does that work really well? Well, the only way to do it is to try it to a bunch of people. And we're doing a trial now, we're just starting up, where our expert bronchoscopists are recruiting people to come in and have this procedure or not, and see how they do over a period of time. Again, that's being done over at Harvard UCLA. And that might be the kind of COPD you have. Glad to hear from you. But please.
There's something that I just pulled up on the internet not too long ago, and I think it is a little different because I'm familiar with this valve, or they called it a coil earlier on. Well, this one has the picture of it. It looks like something that's on a cord.
Yes.
And then is that the one you're talking about?
No, that's well, I don't know. There's a couple of different ways that people have, people are ingenious.
This one is already being used.
None of these things are approved by FDA for use. They're all investigational now. And I'll tell you the different ways of getting at this. One way is to take super glue and stuff it up in the airways and then block off the airways. Maybe that works. Or to put something in there that makes the airways sort of scar down. Or another way of doing it is, it's really, really sort of cool, I'm not positive it works, is to take through the bronchoscope and insert a wire that has sort of memory to it that valves. And there's a couple of other ways of doing this, all at the same purpose, all for the special people, for the unusual people. This is not most people who have bad lungs here and okay lungs here. So, good question. My friend. Paul always asks challenging questions. The question is, do we have any information on inhaled stem cells for a lung regeneration, essentially? I'm actually not aware of inhaled stem cell trials. I am aware. There are no ongoing stem cell trials in COPD patients at the moment. He knows pretty well that we did a stem cell trial at Harvard about 4 or 5 years ago, where we gave infused stem cells by vein and hoped they would go to the lungs and take up shop and start doing some good things. It was a small study. We really didn't find any benefit. The good news was we didn't hurt anybody. The bad news was we didn't help anybody. And stem cell research is very, very important. He knows that that's not a major thing we do over at Harvard. It's just not our specialty. But I'm hoping that these things will come through. But nothing that I've seen recently. You sent me some nice stuff, and I've looked at it. I thank you. Come on, daughter, please.
Those of us who have seen Dallas Buyers Club will understand what I'm referring to now, something that I have believed for quite some time, where Matthew McConaughey's character is going to die in 30 days, but he lives for 7 years because he went down to Mexico and got some of their...
Some of what?
Some of their medications in Mexico.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm very curious to know what outside of this country that doesn't require FDA approval is worth looking into.
Okay, let me see. Most of your doctors are my friends, so... here's the bottom line. We sometimes have a delay of a year or two between time drugs are approved overseas, and they're approved here. And that's regulatory stuff. Believe me, the FDA is not evil that way.
No, not evil.
It's just they're a little bit conservative, which is why thalidomide never got here. All right, so there are some good things here. Has some good results. So there are a few drugs out there, mostly bronchodilators, that are perhaps a little bit more effective once a day versus a couple times a day, for instance, that are just being approved in Europe, are not here. But those aren't game changers. There's nothing there that are game changers. On the other hand, if you go out to Tijuana and Sonata, nice places, and go to a place that gives giving stem cell treatments, I'll tell you that's not a good thing to do. That's not a good thing to do. You go to Canada or Mexico and find a cheap version of Spiriva, and it's not from India. It's really stuff. It's cheaper. That's fine. But I can't tell you that there's anything wonderful out there that we're being denied right now. There's nothing that's...
What do you know about it, Dr. Casaburi, if you were to...
The word would reach me. I mean, I read the literature. I go to hell. If you want me to show my vacation pictures... they're not my vacation pictures. I go to meeting pictures around. So I travel around a lot. I know what's out there.
Right.
And there's nothing that's wonderful, game-changing medicine that you can get elsewhere you can't get here.
Okay. Sorry. Me too.
What about the one for fibrosis, pulmonary fibrosis?
Pulmonary fibrosis is not my area of expertise. I'm a COPD person 100% of the time. The good news about pulmonary fibrosis is there's now starting to be one or two drugs that look promising for pulmonary fibrosis. The bad news is there's nothing else. In COPD, we have a bunch of drugs that we sort of are familiar with. They're not cures, but they're helpful. Pulmonary fibrosis has been very frustrating, not being able to find anything that really makes a lot of difference. Now there's some glimmers of hope that there's some that will, again, not cures necessarily, but do have some effectiveness. And my understanding is that they're getting close to being approved for the purpose. Do you know anything more about that, about the fibrosis drugs?
It's the same that you said.
Yeah. There's a very good group up at UCLA Westwood that has a fibrosis study group, and they're the area experts in this field. Sorry, I saw a question back here. Sir?
What are some of the causes of exacerbations?
Causes of exacerbations. The main causes are infections, viruses, and bacteria. And that's majority of times when you get an exacerbation, you'll have gotten a lower respiratory tract. You'll have gotten either a bacteria or a virus that's infecting you. We get very fussy about this and try very hard to find out what the cause of the exacerbation. We get sputum, we look under a microscope, and we get very, very fussy about that. We don't do that much anymore. We treat them all sort of with an antibiotic and with an oral prednisone type drugs. Less commonly, air pollution, some irritants in the air, but usually it's an infection. Often it's like a cold, sort of, and your defenses are low. The cold is a virus and it causes you to get sick. That's the best I can do.
Thank you.
Sure. Anything else, guys?